So if you've been following this page for a while, you've probably heard of the term antioxidant. Most of you probably already heard of antioxidants before I came along. They're a lot more common to hear about now. And how do antioxidants work? Well, anti, against, oxidants, against the prooxidants that contribute to oxidative stress by donating their electrons to the reactive species in your body that are missing their electrons. The missing of those electrons is what makes them unstable and really reactive, some more reactive than others. But what makes antioxidants really cool is that they can donate their electrons without becoming unstable themselves. So the mantra has been, eat more of these antioxidants to fight off free radicals, and then you'll be healthy. So you gotta buy them, right? So I do refer to the earth as an antioxidant, but that's not to be confused with dietary antioxidants, because there's a difference. Even though you're taking in both from outside the body, they'd both be considered exogenous and they both involve electrons. So why do I call the earth an antioxidant? Because the negative charge at the surface of the earth is essentially this pool of electrons that the body can conduct into itself. And the mechanism of healing is different from dietary antioxidants when it comes to grounding, which is conductive contact with the ground and its electronic properties. If you guys remember a while back, I was talking about the antioxidant paradox, which is what they call the disappointing phenomena of dietary and therapeutic antioxidants having little to no effect on disease and inflammation, sometimes even making it worse. Which makes sense, because you need free radicals to rip electrons from invading pathogens, damaged cells, cancerous cells. If these go unchecked and antioxidant therapy is targeting all of these free radicals and potentially even exaggerating the process, yeah, it's not good. In a test tube, antioxidants work really well, but when they're introduced into the body in vivo, they don't work very well. So all of that put a nice little dent in the whole antioxidant theory, even the theory of grounding, just weeded out the weak ones. Just kidding. But it does force us to look a little deeper and beyond our own biases when there's academic adversity like that. Like I said before, theories can change, but you can't change the data that's associated with grounding the body. We know that there are good, positive things happening physiologically and psychologically when you're grounded. And I don't think the theory behind grounding changes so much. It's just important to understand the mechanism behind dietary antioxidant therapy and conducted antioxidant therapy. Those studies don't take into account how grounding antioxidants work. With inflammation, which we could say is a local response to trauma or injury or infection, this creates a wall of sorts around the affected tissue until the immune system can take care of it. And they call this wall the inflammatory barricade. This barricade prevents the bacteria or pathogens or debris from leaving the inflamed area and affecting nearby tissues, which is fantastic. The only problem is that this inflammatory barricade can be impermeable. So antibiotics and antioxidants, like the ones your body makes endogenously or the ones you consume, aren't able to pass through and do their job. This makes the healing process a lot slower and not as efficient. There's a big difference between endogenous antioxidants, dissolved antioxidants, and ground electrons as far as how they can move. So inflammation and oxidative stress, which are arguably the biggest perpetuators of disease, they go hand in hand. And within this barricade, you've got these two processes feeding off each other in these pockets of inflammation that can turn into a chronic problem that can go on for a really long time. It's called silent inflammation. And these pockets can release toxins into the body that affect nearby tissues and organs. So local inflammation can turn into multi-systemic inflammation. And the silent inflammation goes unnoticed for years until it manifests itself in a big way, like in a disease. So how are these inflammatory barricades formed? So let's look at one of the mechanisms of your immune response. So phagocytes, these eat up microorganisms and damaged cells and create what are called phagosomes. And these phagosomes get attacked by reactive oxygen species or free radicals. And the production of these reactive oxygen species uses up oxygen, creates what's called an oxidative burst. And within this oxidative burst, you've got reactive species like superoxide and hydrogen peroxide that kill damaged cells, pathogens, and other things. This oxidative burst creates, especially in an insulated organism, the inflammatory barricade or pouch or granuloma. So the free radicals that are released into the area, they create a lot of collateral damage and debris that coagulate to form these barricades. And it's essentially this wall of connective tissue. If you go back to a video I did a long time ago on exercise and grounding, there's been an observed reduction in white blood cell activity with less circulating neutrophils and lymphocytes. This may be because there is less damage and accelerated recovery rate. So the main hypothesis here is that conducting electrons into the body reduces the collateral damage created by free radicals and ultimately these inflammatory barricades. And this creates a much more stable healing environment. And what's the traditional approach to inflammation? Anti-inflammatory drugs, diet recommendations, supplemental antioxidants. I'm not saying these are bad things, of course, but for a long while, antioxidant therapy in conjunction with anti-inflammatories were thought to be the key in fighting off disease and aging. But the antioxidant paradox showed us otherwise, at least for antioxidants. And one of the reasons antioxidant therapy doesn't work is because it's not selective enough in what it targets. So it could get rid of some things, it could exaggerate other things. And on top of that, the inflammatory barricade. So in this traditional approach, antibiotics, anti-inflammatories, more so specifically antioxidants, that inflammatory barricade is going to prevent these from circulating in and neutralizing some of these free radicals. Because remember that this barricade is relatively impermeable to letting molecules within the inflammatory zone. But remember what this barricade is made out of. It's connective tissue, the matrix, mostly collagen molecules. And you'll remember from my last video on the matrix that collagen is a semiconductor. And semiconductors are materials that allow for electron conduction and flow between an insulator and a conductor. And now we get to the most important part here in terms of the difference between endogenous, the ones your body already makes, dietary antioxidants, and the antioxidants you conduct from the ground. That semiconductive barricade isolates the inflammatory zone where oxidative stress and inflammation, those pathways are feeding off each other. It isolates it so it doesn't affect nearby tissues. But it also prevents antioxidants from getting access to the free radicals within and neutralizing them. Electrons, on the other hand, can cross this barrier through semiconduction. And that's the big difference between the Earth's surface antioxidants and dietary or endogenous antioxidants. They can go where others can't, and they can traverse this conductive collagen matrix that connects everything within. So I think that's an important thing to know if you're going to be lumping antioxidants together. What you get from the ground is different than what you consume or supplement with, as far as maneuverability goes.